Welcome to American Photo Books, a podcast of stories and pictures from our lives. I'm your host, Thomas Anderson. Today on Behind the Lens, my guest is Peter Doyle, well-known and respected photographer and judge of many photo contests. I've asked Peter to help us sort through some of the questions you need to ask yourself when you're thinking about joining a camera club. Welcome, Peter, and thank you for being on the podcast.
Well, thank you. I'm glad to be here.
You've been a member of many camera clubs over the years. Can you recall what it was like for you when you started?
I remember that it was a pleasurable experience. I liked what I saw. I liked the people. And beyond that, I was motivated to come back.
What did you experience at that club? Did they have a contest or did they have a lecture?
I believe the first one I went to, meeting I attended, there was a contest. And so it was an open contest and the people brought in whatever photograph they wanted to show. And that was judged.
Well, that was a long time ago.
Yeah, a long time ago.
How many years has this been?
Oh, probably 25, 30.
That's a lot of experience with camera clubs. And today you're members of several of them?
I am a member of several of them and a number of meetup groups.
Okay.
Which are also kind of in the genre of camera clubs.
Now, the camera club that you and I belong to, you act as moderator for a discussion of the prints submitted for the monthly competition. What do you have to keep in mind when you're performing this duty for our club?
Well, I think the most important thing to keep in mind is to provide some very constructive information as to what makes this picture work well and perhaps what could make it work better. And that's subject to, it is more of a discussion, and so that is subject to my opinion and the opinions of the people who join into the discussion.
Well, is the discussion sometimes shaded toward being hypercritical and almost mean-spirited? Do you have to kind of watch the participants and make sure they don't drift that direction?
I haven't seen a mean-spirited critical assessment of a photograph in many years. That is not to say that I have never seen one, but that has not seemed to be the tenor of discussion or critique.
So most people act in an adult way. This is an adult conversation, yeah.
Right. You can improve photography by merely pointing out what works in this photograph and not really dwell much on what is wrong with it. If you never said anything bad about a photograph or critical about a photograph, if you never said anything critical about a photograph and you were in the position of leading a discussion group, the people in attendance would create better photographs over time.
Encouragement,
pointing out what is good about a photograph, and people would tend to, it tends to go in the back of your mind, and I think when you look through the viewfinder the next time, even though it's not really a conscious experience, it does work on a subconscious experience, and your photographs do start to show the elements of what you have learned.
Let's take a little time here and look at some of your photographs that you've submitted over the years. You sent several of them to me for our podcast interview. And the first one is obviously a travel photograph of a small village. You told me there is a significant backstory for this photograph that carries emotional significance for you. Can you say more about that?
This was on the Cinque Terre in Italy, and there are five villages connected by a path. And before there was the path, everyone was confined to date and marry the people within their village. Well, the path was made, and then people would traverse from one village to the other. And eventually, it became a practice that they would put a lock on the fence along the trail to proclaim their everlasting love. And so that was very nice, I thought. We actually have a bridge in Cincinnati, and people have started to do the same thing here. So that tribute is seems to have caught on in even locally.
Yeah, I think there's one in Paris too, isn't there?
I've never been to Paris, but I can imagine.
Well, I've seen a picture of a bridge with lots of locks on it.
Well, it is the city of romance and,
right.
and love.
Well, let me just say that this photograph is very interesting from a point of view of somebody submitting it for a competition. Maybe the lesson of this photograph, correct me if I'm wrong, is to make sure whatever photo you submit contains elements that the judges will value. And simply submitting this photograph because you know about this backstory and you have a particular emotion connected with the photograph may not be sufficient for the competition. So you really need to focus on some well-recognized photographic compositional elements rather than just relying upon this significant personal backstory. Do you think that's about, is that good advice?
That is excellent advice. Unfortunately, you not much attention is paid to backstories, or any attention is paid to backstories. Photograph more or less has to speak for itself. So if it does not speak for itself, then much is lost, and the judges cannot give you credit for the backstory that they don't know or is not readily evident.
Well, give us some insight into what the judges are looking for in a print.
Judges have thresholds of quality a print must demonstrate. It must be sharp, but not over-sharpened. It has to have the correct color, and or, said another way, no color biases. It needs to have a sufficient range of tonal values and free of obvious flaws, such as what we might call banding, or dust, or wrinkles when you mount it. So that is the first thing they're looking for, is that it has to come up with certain standards that they would consider this to be mm-hmm. a artistic print. After you've met the thresholds for the photograph, then I think the judges are looking for composition, the content of the photograph, how much impact it has, and the technical quality that may give interpretation to the subject matter.
Going on to this next photograph of a lighthouse, you were telling me earlier that this lighthouse photograph did well in the competition because at the time there was a strong bias toward photographs containing lighthouses and fog. How can a preference for certain photographs affect judging, and is that fair?
Well, I think you can talk about unfair and not giving a picture the credit or score that it is due. But one of the major categories for judging a print is impact. And impact is related to the likability of the subject of the picture. Finding a judge that is totally impartial to the subject matter would be difficult and perhaps impossible. I do not believe it's wise for persons to give up photographing what they find significant to please judges or to win ribbons.
Yeah. Happens all the time, though, doesn't it? Trying to figure out what's going to fly at the competition. Well, maybe it's because we don't know who the judges are.
Yeah, maybe.
But it does sound kind of unfair for a judge to come in and rate all the cat pictures very highly.
Yes, and perhaps some judges are aware of that and have enough expertise and range of judging to go beyond some biases. But I think for the most part, judges do have biases, and sometimes very strong ones. You can get judges that are partial to pictures that have been not altered, so to say, or not post-processed very much, and they will not score pictures that have been post-processed very highly. On the other hand, you can get judges that are partial to that, and they will sort of give extra credit in the category of post-processing or technique for those efforts. So I don't think it's something that you could avoid very well. I should mention at this point, something that subtly goes on in photo clubs sometimes is that over time, a certain picture or type of picture begins to win more consistently than other types of pictures. And a person could be beguiled into sort of going in that direction to take pictures like the ones that win. And it can be so gradual and so over time that you don't even realize it's happening to yourself. And all of a sudden you realize that, wow, I've been taking these pictures and I really have no personal interest in these pictures other than they have a greater potential to win a ribbon at the next camera club competition.
You and I have talked in the past about certain camera clubs drifting toward favoring fine art photography as opposed to photojournalism. How would you define these two terms?
I think fine art attempts to show the beauty of a subject for its own sake. I think photojournalism is for picturing an event of perhaps of historical significance. Now, there is overlap. Sometimes people take photojournalistic pictures, and they are so well composed, so technically excellent, that they sort of go towards fine art. And sometimes fine art goes towards photojournalism. Although the person started out to depict the beauty of the place, they also depicted the historical significance or the significance of the place.
Well, let's take two well-known photojournalistic shots. One is the raising of the flag on Mount Suribachi after the Marines took it. Anyway, that's an iconic picture in American history, and it's definitely photojournalism, but here's my thought. Do you think that if a photojournalistic shot has tremendous emotion, that it tends to move people more into the direction of fine art photography? Take, for example, the shot of John Kennedy Jr. saluting his father's hearse during that funeral procession. Those things kind of move everybody so much that maybe they are willing to say those should be fine art photography.
Well, definitely the story, if it is so strong and compelling, would move something, especially if it's timeless, would tend to move the photograph towards being fine art. But I think also that the photograph has to have the technical quality to go with it. And sometimes the technical quality can be quite bad. It can be a quite grainy shot, but if it seems like the grain of the photograph and the grittiness of the photograph goes with the subject matter, then, you know, that would go into it being a fine art photograph.
Well, let's look at the peacock feather shot that you took. Would you classify this as fine art photography?
Yes.
Okay.
Most definitely, because the photograph was taken to show the beauty of the peacock feather.
Well, you gave me some bullet points about the pros and cons of camera club membership. Let me just give you these bullet points and let you respond. Being a newcomer to a club, it's easy to be misled by so-called expert advice.
That is true. I think what you need to do is get advice from more than one person and to kind of take into account what you would like to take photographs of, how much gear you would like to carry, whether you plan to mainly photograph out of the trunk of your car and just walk a short distance or travel on an airplane to a faraway place. All of those things you should recognize in yourself and then be guided as to what people tell you are the good things to have or the proper equipment or the techniques to follow when you're taking photographs.
And you also mentioned being careful about being sabotaged by insensitive critics.
Yeah. Well, I think there's dream slayers in all aspects of life, and you have to be somewhat tough-skinned sometimes when people discuss your photographs, but it's also good to recognize when someone is just being critical for being critical. I think if someone criticizes your work or tells you something that's how your work should be improved, you should come away with a feeling that A, you're uplifted, that you can make these improvements, and B, that if you do that, your photographs will be better. You shouldn't come away with the feeling that, gee, I'm discouraged by what this person told me.
You also mentioned finding where your heart is in photography and not pandering to the judges. How do you do that?
I think, well, it can be difficult because, as I said earlier, that sometimes you just drift towards taking the pictures that seem to do well in a camera club. You just have to be vigilant of that. Try to maintain your own personal locus of control within yourself and take photographs that have meaning to yourself. Camera clubs can be enormously valuable. They can be a continual source of inspiration and of information. A club can expand one's horizons through workshops. They can suggest special topics for you to photograph, which you may not have picked on your own. They can have field trips and outings, sort of encourage you to go with them to places that you normally would not think of photographing. There's a possibility of really having some social relationships and gaining some long-term friendships.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's end on a personal note. Let's move away from your role as judge and ask, what inspires you as a photographer? When you get that camera in your hand, what happens to you when you find that image that you're looking for? How do you do that?
Well, I think the camera has found me. I did not find the camera. And I think I love to show photographically natural beauty, the design of things, people, culture. And as I said before, I really enjoy showing these photographically and have an image of these, the things that I have experienced in my life.
Today on our podcast, we've been talking with Cincinnati photographer and judge Peter Doyle. Thank you very much, Peter, for being on the podcast.
You're welcome.
Thank you for listening to our podcast. For more stories and pictures, visit our website, AmericanPhotoBooks.com.